Hey guys, welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show. We give you all the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Jeremy Jahns, are you making fun of me? Leading off the show today is Mark Ellis.
Welcome one and all to the best movie news show in the entire galaxy. My name is Mark, and on today's episode of Movie Talk, Hillbillies Get Poems, Daisy Ridley might get to go to Skywalker Ranch, and all you guys definitely will get the info on our meet and greet happening at Star Wars Celebration this Thursday. But Ashley, I can't make the magic up here by myself. So who is joining me on this jungle cruise full of dad jokes?
Your magician's assistants are Jeremy John.
Hello, everybody. The dad joke river ride brought to you by
Darth Vader himself from Rogue One.
Also here, Perri Nemiroff.
We're all in for it today. It's Taco Tuesday, and that means things get crazy.
Also here is Jon Schnepp.
Or you could call it Happy Tuesday for all you idiots who don't know who Led Zeppelin is.
Should probably know who Led Zeppelin is, and if you're in the Burbank area, you should definitely know who Jon Schnepp's dentist is. More on that later in the show. For right now, Ashley, what's our first official topic?
The first trailer for Star Wars The Last Jedi is expected to drop this Friday at the annual celebration event in Orlando, Florida. Unlike the first teaser from The Force Awakens, which was only 90 seconds in length, Star Wars News Net is hearing from their sources that The Last Jedi trailer will definitely have the full trailer feel and not just a brief teaser. This week is a big one for Star Wars fans. With Celebration kicking off this Thursday, a new Force for Change campaign launched this morning with Mark Hamill and Daisy Ridley. Starting today, April 11th through May 11, 2017, fans can enter at omaze.com/Star Wars for a chance to win a ticket to The Last Jedi premiere, a trip to Skywalker Ranch, or a walk-on part in the young Han Solo movie. Mark, you'll be at Celebration. What do you expect to see from the convention, and do you think we'll get a full trailer for The Last Jedi based on the new reports?
Well, Ashley, yes, I am very excited to go to Star Wars Celebration. We're leaving tomorrow morning. Now, first off, let's get to this, because Good Morning America had Mark Hamill and Daisy Ridley on the show today. This is why I never get excited about morning talk show news, because Good Morning America, maybe it's great white noise if you're a soccer parent or you just got home from an all-night rave. I cannot stand morning shows because you have to watch 5 hours of them just to get to 2 minutes of stuff you actually care about. It was a nice little announcement with Mark Hamill and Daisy Ridley that was pre-taped talking about their charity work with Omaze, including the UNICEF Foundation. So all great stuff. Props to them. Now, when you get to actually what are we going to see at Celebration? Are we going to get a Last Jedi teaser trailer? Is it going to be a full trailer? Is it going to be somewhere in the middle? That's where I think it's going to land. Now, let's go back to the Force Awakens promo where they had that brief snippet where you just had a couple quick clips and we ended with the Millennium Falcon once again. That was Thanksgiving. So we should have already gotten something like that, right? Well, no, not necessarily, because The Force Awakens had to announce to the world at large that Star Wars is coming back into theaters. Now with The Last Jedi, we know it's coming back into theaters, so we're expecting to get that first teaser look. However, I think it's going to be a longer teaser trailer. I don't think it's going to be a full trailer in the sense where they give us a lot of story. And as Jeremy and I were talking about before the show, we don't necessarily want a trailer ever that gives us too much of the story. I want to see a lot of quick clips. I want to see some iconic images of people I know and maybe a surprise Force ghost in there at the end or a green lightsaber igniting. Either way, Jeremy, we're going to be there live at Star Wars Celebration on Friday in the arena when they debut this hopefully trailer. What are you expecting to get a glimpse of?
I'm expecting to do a mad scramble through a crowd to get my camera ready to be like, all right, here's what I saw, but as fast as I possibly can after I see the trailer. I'll try, but I'm with you. That one that we got that was the 90-second one, that's a teaser trailer. It's the kind of trailer you get a year out, so I don't think we're going to get something like that. We're going to get something in the vein of the second trailer we got. That was the Chewie We're Home one, right?
Chewie We're Home, yeah, which I think is a perfect hybrid of a teaser and a full trailer.
Absolutely, yeah. So, I mean, in a world where it's Star Wars, do you really think they need to give any plot point whatsoever in order for people to be like, oh my gosh, I'm totally watching this today? You know, they don't. They need to be like, hey, here's The Last Jedi, here's some imagery, and we'll all be there the moment we find out that pre-sale tickets go on. We've bought it just right then and there. So I want something. It's about, what is that, 7 months out? I'm horrible at
math. I mean,
math
look,
right
if
now,
you're going to
so
put me on the spot with
like
math.
It's 9 months out.
Is it 9 months out? Okay, so I'm expecting, as a former projectionist, Jon Schnepp, I think that we're going to get somewhere along the lines of a teaser trailer that shows more than the first trailer that we got last time, and somewhere around the lines of a second trailer. That's how we would do it in the movie theater, because that's how it's going to be.
That is every projectionist in the world. And Jon Schnepp, you are correct. It is 9 months out. So if you get somebody pregnant to start Wars Celebration, you can take your new kid to see The Last Jedi. Perri, you drive a Mini Cooper, which is kind of like a hybrid of a station wagon and a coupe. Do you think we're going to get a hybrid trailer that's going to be somewhere in the mix of a teaser and a full one?
I do, and it's only because I drive a Mini Cooper. It just makes sense.
The Italian job right there.
Yeah, that's exactly what I do down the streets of Burbank, which is why I have a ticket. I was really happy, actually, with how everything panned out this morning, because I was a little nervous yesterday that they were going to reveal a little too much. And this Omaze thing is great. When you're a big property like Star Wars, good on them to use that kind of airtime and getting those kinds of eyes to promote something great. Because not only can you enter to win super cool prizes, it's for a freaking awesome cause. And right before gearing up for Star Wars Celebration, I mean, what better way to get fans pumped about Star Wars, to spread a good cause and just get that word out there. And then you know what? We'll get what we were hoping for in the next few days. I really think that we're going to end up, though, seriously, with a hybrid type trailer, a little something in between a teaser and a full trailer that leaves the door open to giving a more story-driven trailer down the line, which I'm looking forward to. But more so than what I expect to get a Last Jedi trailer at Star Wars Celebration. I'm looking forward to the announcement that I don't see coming. And I would hope that would have something to do with the announcement of another standalone movie, maybe a different TV series, something. I just can't wait for that moment in that big arena when we're just sitting there and they drop a little like nugget of information. Everyone's like, no way. Because not only is that exciting for the future of the film and TV franchise, having that kind of communal experience and just everyone erupting at that moment, like, I want that feeling.
Good on you, Perri, for reminding us that Star Wars is a huge corporation when you break it down and they're doing something good for charity. Yes, I can complain about wasting a lot of time watching Good Morning America this morning, but they're doing something nice and they saved the snippet. There wasn't like what we speculated yesterday of a 10-second teaser of the teaser. We didn't get anything from The Last Jedi until Friday. Schnepp, you are not going to be at Star Wars Celebration. You're going to be watching it online with the rest of the world.
I might be watching it on my phone.
So what are you looking forward to?
Watching it on my phone. I'm looking forward to, you know what? I'll see if it's just a weird shot of a creature, you know, hanging out in the dirt, and there's a Star Wars music, I'll be excited.
That's all you need to see. You don't need to see anything more than that. You'll need to see The Last Jedi. You don't want to see a Force Ghost of Yoda or Obi-Wan show up.
Absolutely nothing other than a creature sniffing some dirt with the Star Wars music. No, of course I want. I want to see Yoda. I want to see, well, he's dead. Force Ghost Yoda.
Yeah.
I'd love to see a green lightsaber or a blue lightsaber held by Luke Skywalker. That's the shot I'm looking for, is not only Luke Skywalker saying a word, but maybe doing like a backflip or something. If we see Snoke and Luke Skywalker fighting, people are going to freak out. I mean, I think we're going to see something like that's going to freak everybody out. Like when I was a little kid and I saw the trailer for The Empire Strikes Back, I remember like I went to go and just sit through movies just so that I could see that trailer again. And that scene of Darth Vader like jumping after Luke Skywalker, you know, in the movie it happens really quick. Luke falls down those stairs, and then you see Vader like almost fly and like crush his head. I just remember like I couldn't believe that. I was like, oh my God, Darth Vader's fighting Luke Skywalker. It just freaked me out. So I hope that all the kids out there get some of that kind of like flavor of like something that none of us are expecting to see. Just a real quick shot. That's what I love about these kind of trailers, especially in Star Wars, is you have these. You see aliens, you see spaceships, you see planets, you see all the main character head turns, and there's one or two of those shots that just burn into your brain. So that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I think that Chewie We're Home trailer was so spectacular in the way that it announced Star Wars was back, because you had that opening shot of the crashed Star Destroyer on Jakku, where it really gave us a nice glimpse into the world that we're going to be dealing with 30 years after Return of the Jedi. We got some neat imagery, and then at the end, we got a great nostalgia tug, and we also got something new to talk about, which is Han and Chewie, they're back. Did they lose the Falcon? Are they, in fact, in the Falcon? I'm expecting some heartstring pulls and also something really awesome and a left curve that we're not expecting. A left turn. It's like, oh my God, I can't believe they showed us that. We need to talk about this for the next 4 or 5 months until we get the next and hopefully last Jedi trailer. Make sure you guys go to omaze.com/Star Wars if you want to help contribute, maybe win a chance to go to the Last Jedi premiere. And of course, later in this show, we're going to give you guys details on the panels we're doing at Star Wars Celebration, as well as our Thursday night meet and greet. But for right now, Ashley, let's move on to hillbillies.
According to Variety, Ron Howard and his Imagine Entertainment Company have won in a bidding war the rights to direct and produce an adaptation of J.D. Vance's best-selling novel, Hillbilly Elegy. Per Variety, Vance's book recaps growing up in the Rust Belt and the everyday struggles of America's white working class as they navigate through drug addiction and social and economic challenges. No word on when the adaptation will go in front of cameras, with a release date not yet determined. Jeremy, thoughts on a Hillbilly Elegy adaptation directed by Ron Howard?
Well, in a world where I don't know much about that book, I have to go on the merits of Ron Howard. I used to love Ron Howard's movies unconditionally, and then at a point, he became about 50-50 for me. I don't look forward to his films as much as I used to. So in a world of 50-50, I have to be apprehensive and be like, okay, so the news is there is a book that's being adapted with no release date, and they're not filming it yet. So Ron Howard's doing a movie. I'm going to have to wait to see a trailer to see if I get excited. And even then, I'm going to remember that Hemsworth whale movie that I already forgot about. So sure, I guess he's making a movie. I really want it to be good because I want him to get back in my good graces. You know, I remember when I saw Ransom in theaters, man, it freaked. I was like, that is such a cool thriller. And then a couple other movies were great. Apollo 13 is right. A great. And then after that, it's like 2010 hit. And he was like, yeah, sure. And then here we are.
Ron Howard did a really cool car movie once upon a time.
Yes,
it also had Chris Hemsworth in it.
Great,
yeah.
One.
And so Ron Howard clearly still has the storytelling ability. And if you're talking about the Rust Belt, or you're talking about any type of middle class and the struggles that they're going through, whether it's been in the last few decades in America or what's going on right now, I think it's a worthy story to tell. And as somebody who has more than a few roots in the hillbilly world, I think this is something that I would be intrigued by. I also listened to a lot of John Mellencamp on the weekend, so this would be right up my alley. Hillbilly Elegy, as Schnepp pointed out in the pre-meeting. What is an elegy?
It is a poem about the dead, like a lament.
Ooh, so it's like we're lamenting the end of the working class or the middle class in America. So I think it's some real noteworthy features in there, and Ron Howard's harder-hitting dramas. Like we talked about Apollo 13, that built a lot of suspense towards the end. You also have movies like Cinderella Man that really gave a picture and immersed us in the world of a man who's fighting for his family and for his own redemption. I think that we're going to get those kind of notes of Ron Howard, and so I'm looking forward to that. The guy's a great filmmaker. I hope he comes back with a punch here. Perri, what do you think?
I think this could be a solid pairing. I mean, you're not wrong, Jeremy. Yeah. He hasn't really delivered too many solid movies as a director lately, although I do really like Rush. I was very disappointed by In the Heart of the Sea, though, because that's a great book, and it had... There were so many elements of it that made it a great opportunity to adapt, just in terms of it having the things that really do feel cinematic, but then also those things that you take out and try to like infuse in the background, because that was very much about the main characters, where they are in life and in that community and in their business and how that affects them when they're out on the sea and they're facing all these crazy hardships. That all comes to the forefront. So maybe his experience on that will kind of pave the way to exploring that here. This seems like a much more, I don't want to say low budget because I don't know what they're planning visually or anything for this, but this does seem like a smaller, more contained, character-driven kind of story. I was reading a couple of reviews of the book, and most of them praise the fact that the author, it's about the author and it's about his experience, and he also offers just a somewhat like unique perspective where he's explaining what he's been through, but also just that culture in general and what we assume is how they are, but what he really saw. And it just seems like there's enough unique perspective to make this a really interesting, moving story that it might be very different. And just looking back at some of the movies where Ron Howard is a more successful director, it seems like when he finds a character that he could really explore to that extent, it could be something good, but it's so hard to tell far out.
I'll tell you, the actual pairing, this match made in heaven, is a movie with Hillbilly in the title and Clint Howard's inevitable cameo in this movie. That's what I would look forward to.
This
more
is the role that
anything.
Clint Howard has dreamed about That's his entire right. life. Hillbilly Elegy, Schnepp, what do you think?
You know, it sounds like this is a perfect thing for Ron Howard. It feels like maybe the whale movie didn't really fit. And, you know, he's like, when directors are looking for projects and material, especially if they didn't write the material themselves, this sounds very grounded. This sounds like he could get behind the character that's telling a story. It's an Americana tale. It's a tale that all of us are going through right now as we watch America go through a lot of changes. you know, I think, you know, the meth and all the drugs and like the lack of education, you know, as we see a lot of states break down and the family break down. I think that's really important to talk about. I don't know what the contents of the book are. I haven't read it, but from the description of it, it sounds pretty deep. Sounds like it could be like an Oscar contender if it's done right, if it's cast right, if it's written right. So all those elements probably drew Ron Howard towards it because he's looking to make a great film. Every single director always wants to make a great film when they start. So I'm going to be looking forward to it.
Okay. I have a feeling that's when I'm going to start getting really excited about it, when I find out who's cast in the lead role.
On the spot, Ron Howard fantasy draft, your best Ron Howard movie. I'm going first, Apollo 13. Jeremy, what do you got?
So I can't take Apollo.
You can't take Apollo 13. You can take Willow still.
Ransom.
Perry, what do you got? Willow, still on the board. It's still on the board.
If you guys took those two off the board, I'm going with Rush. It was one of my favorite movies of whatever year that came out.
Yeah, mine too. It was on my top 10.
Jon Schnepp, you have Splash you can still take. You have Cinderella
Splash?
Man.
Right.
You had, that was his first movie.
Right.
You have the Whale movie.
Now, he just acted in Grand Theft Auto, right? He didn't direct that.
I don't believe he directed Grand Theft Auto.
All right, well, I was going to say Grand Theft Auto, but I'll go with Splash.
He's taking Splash now. It's up to you guys in the live chat. Let us know right now. And while you guys are delivering about Ron Howard movies, we're going to move on to a franchise that has films he'll probably never direct. Ashley, what's coming out in theaters this weekend?
It's The Fate of the Furious. Now that Dom, Vin Diesel, and Letty, Michelle Rodriguez, are on their honeymoon, Brian and Mia have retired from the game, and the rest of the crew has been exonerated from the globetrotting team that has found a semblance of a normal life. But when a mysterious woman seduces Dom back into a world of crime that he can't seem to escape, the crew will face trials that will test them like never before.
Okay, look, guys, I don't know what to think about this. I am terrified because, look, I go to Fast and Furious movies for one thing. Family. And if Dom Toretta is no longer in the family, I don't know what to think. Jeremy, is this real?
I'm looking at those posters and I'm seeing Family No More.
No More!
Never give up on family. Family Guy on Fox, 8 p.m. You know, it's just, I am looking forward to Fast 8 because, I mean, the first Fast and the Furious movie was a remake of Point Break. Let's just be honest. And I saw it. It was Point Break for like car, muscle car heads. And that wasn't me. I was like, Shrek had the new trailer for Attack of the Clones. Let's watch it again. That was me. I didn't gravitate to Fast and the Furious. So I didn't see the next two. Then I heard the fourth one actually went another direction. So I saw the fifth one and I enjoyed it because they became heist movies at a point, and they just became ridiculous action heist movies.
Right.
It's like the franchise became self-aware. It knows what it is and it lives it up. And the most important thing any person or movie franchise or movie in general can do is just know what they are and just play that strength up. It looks like Fast and the Furious has done that. I'm looking forward to it for sure. I mean, is it going to be Macbeth? No, it's not going to be Amadeus 2 or anything like that. But I mean, I'm looking forward to it because I expect to have a good time.
We're going to be seeing it tonight. And Schnepp, one can be forgiven if when you watch Fast 5 or 6 or 7, you start to sense a shark in the waters. And we're just waiting for Arthur Fonzarelli to get on a motorcycle and try to jump right over that thing. Is this the movie where the Fast franchise jumps the Predator?
I think they jumped the submarine. That's what people are going to be calling this one. But you know what? Is it extreme heist? Can it be overdone? I mean, I don't go to see these films to I really don't go to see these films to expect any form of a story or emotional character development or even like family. I mean, the last one was moving because of what happened with Paul Walker and the way they dealt with that. And I thought that was really well done for what the franchise is, which is basically an over-the-top action adventure. So with the trailers for this just going over the top, literally, you know, jumping submarines, The Rock kicking a missile. I mean, it's so dumb and it's so dumb and insane that it makes me want to go see it. And I know a couple of advanced reviews were saying it was, you know, it's not all it's, you know, cracked up to be. I don't know. I guess I'll find out when I go see it tonight, but I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, Perry, I don't know what trailer Schnepp was watching because The Rock, in no trailers, does he kick a missile. He touches a torpedo.
He toe touches a torpedo. He toe touches a torpedo.
It's very different than kicking a missile.
Kicking it.
Perry, you're excited about The Fate of the Furious.
I'm very excited, and I actually do really like the family element of it. And I'm with you, Jeremy. I got back into this franchise at 5. 5, 6, and 7 are great, and I think the way you described it is perfect. That's that's the point in this franchise where they realize what was so great about it and what really resonates with people, and they just ran with it in 5, 6, and 7, both with batshit crazy stunts, like dropping cars out of planes, but then they really do take the family element pretty serious, and even though these stunts are absolutely crazy and ridiculous, when characters are in harm's way, I get nervous, and one of my favorite scenes is the abnormally long runway scene where a certain something happens to one of the characters and it's freaking sad. So I actually love this for all the crazy action that they keep selling, and the family stuff works pretty well for me too. Badly. So I hope we get both in this. I am very curious to see where this ends up, given probably Vin Diesel is the one who said about this is the end of like a trilogy in this, and then there's going to be three more that kind of feel like their own trilogy or something. So I'm curious to see how they wrap this one up to then pave the way to that.
I know on Collider Video, Vin Diesel had a pretty impressive press conference y'all should check out. We are a family here at Collider, so I want to go over to two other family members about the fate of the Furious right now. Ashley, Wendy, is this a movie that you guys are looking forward to?
Stop trying to make Fast and Furious happen. It's not going to happen. Oh, I'm so over this franchise.
Haters Corner. Look at that. Haters Corner.
Haters Corner. Are we going to go to movie 700? I'm so over this franchise. The one thing that almost made me intrigued back into this franchise is James Wan, and even then I didn't go to see it because I'm so over it. So, not into it.
I got to side with my Haters Corner girl, Ashley Mova. I'm seeing it tonight. Because I'm curious, but the only... Jeremy, stop shaking
Fast
your head.
Fast and the Curious.
Stop shaking your head. So I've only seen the first one, and then I didn't see any of the other ones. I'm going to catch up at 8. So it's going to be real interesting to see how that whole thing goes and see if I can even connect the story from 1 to 8, because apparently... it's completely different.
I hope you guys can focus on it, and I hope Perry's not sitting right next to me, because I'm just warning you right now, this is going to be a too large corn night for Mark Ellis. I haven't been to the movies in a little bit.
I definitely won't be sitting next to you, because you'll be in the front row, and I won't.
I will be in the front row, just shoving popcorn in my face, watching all this stupidity happen on a giant screen, and I'm looking forward to a good, fun time. It's currently fresh on Rotten Tomatoes at 86%. Nice. We'll see what we have to say after tonight. Make sure you guys stay tuned to Collider Video for the review that should be out sometime tomorrow. All right, with that, we're going to move on to Buy or Sell. This is the part of the show where Ashley's going to give us a premise, hopefully not about Fate of the Furious, lest she gets even more angry at me. And we're going to simply say whether we buy it or sell it. What's up first?
According to Deadline, Rat Pat Entertainment and Brett Ratner have secured the life rights for a biopic on Playboy founder Hugh Hefner. The film is currently without a writer or director, but Brett Ratner will now begin the process of developing the movie as a producer from the ground up. The movie is a passion project for the director-producer, who has been trying to get the movie off the ground for over a decade, hiring a number of writers in the process and working alongside Brian Grazer at Imagine Entertainment at one time. Ratner now has the rights and the blessings from Hugh Hefner himself, who released the following statement. In recent years, there has been plenty of interest and much conversation about doing a feature film based on my life. I have always believed that when the timing was truly right, the perfect creative partners would come together for this project. I believe we've found those partners in Brett Ratner and Rat Pack Entertainment. I'm very much looking forward to this collaboration. Schnepp, buy or sell a biopic on Hugh Hefner with Brett Ratner producing.
I'm going to buy it. I mean, I know that they've been in the development process on the Hugh Hefner biopic for decades, and Brett Ratner was originally involved many decades ago, one decade ago, and then it lost the rights, went into a lot of turnaround, other people developed it. It'll be interesting to see how they approach it. I mean, with Playboy and where we are now in our culture, it's like, it almost Playboy seems passé to a certain degree. So I'm really interested to see how they're going to approach it. Like Hugh Hefner, you know, in the 50s, 60s, are they going to, you know, go decade by decade through his life and the changes and how our culture changed? I mean, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I'll buy it because the story of Hugh Hefner is something that I think people are going to have some sort of interest in, even if they go in with the kind of okay, let's go see what this is. Because for Hugh Hefner to say that he's been waiting his entire life for Brett Ratner to come along, I can't really buy that part of the statement. It sounds like it was uttered when he was wearing a silk robe in between a blue pill and a yellow pill. But look, this is Hugh Hefner. This is a guy whose story clearly has been out there in the public. We know his public persona. I'd like to know more about the business side of Hugh Hefner building this empire with Playboy. I don't think that Brett Ratner has done a lot recently. I mean, he You know, he did a Hercules movie. He did Tower Heist, which I got some laughs out of. He says a lot of idiotic things sometimes in the press, so I don't get excited about Brett Ratner doing upcoming projects. But if Hugh Hefner seems excited about it, Hugh Hefner feels like it's the right time in his life to make a Playboy movie, because I'm sure he actually wants to go to the premiere. Hugh Hefner's getting long in the tooth, so if we're going to make a movie and Hugh's going to be around to see it, we should probably go ahead and do it now and get off the pot. Jeremy, Hugh Hefner, Brett Ratner, what say you?
Blue pills, yellow pills. I don't know if that's a Matrix reference or another Saturday Night at Casa de Jahns. Either way, I'm liking it, and I really like where your head's at, Mark. I was apprehensive about this when I thought Brett Ratner was directing it. Brett Ratner producing it, mm-hmm. If they get another director, totally buying it. Hugh Hefner has an interesting life. It'll actually culturally be interesting, like you were saying, Schnepp. I was like, Playboy's like, it's... You know, it's not that crazy these days. And so it'll be funny seeing it in the 50s. People are like, she shows her leg. You can't do that. You know? So, I mean, culturally speaking, I think it'll be a neat little view into the 50s. And just the guy does have an interesting life. I do believe that Hefner's been waiting all his life for a movie to happen. Ratner's like, dude, have you seen it? Come on. And he's like, yeah, sure, you'll do. You know, so I do think that if there was, I was not the least bit surprised when I heard Brett Ratner was producing this movie at all.
Right.
So, I mean, if we get the right crew behind it for directing, yeah, totally. Looking forward to this one.
Yeah, and I mean, like, one of the reasons I buy it is because you would hope that what they'd be able to do with a story like this is turn it into the cultural touchstone that Playboy was, not a celebration of Hugh Hefner's mansion, because I don't really care about that. I care more about a story like The People versus Larry Flint, where it also became like a free speech issue or something like that. So, Perri, if that's the lofty goal, do you buy or sell this movie with Brett Ratner producing?
I'm going to buy it. Throwing Brett Ratner's name in the mix doesn't really give me as much hope as if, you know, someone else that I really admired was in there. But at the same time, you know, Brett Ratner has been somewhat involved in this project for a very long time. They've had so many iterations of this that just don't take off. And if he's had, you know, even the slightest hand in on that situation and saw what didn't work and why it couldn't go on, I don't know, maybe he is the right guy to kind of spearhead something like this in order to make it happen, because I do think we really do need a Hugh Hefner movie, because, I mean, everything he's accomplished, it's easy nowadays to be like, oh, like, Playboy, you know, like, what is it anymore versus what it was even just 10 years ago? It changed the world in a really big way, and based on, I think the original source for the story came from Deadline, and the way that they presented in their article, it seems like it's going to focus more on the earlier years, which I certainly want to hear more about, so I'm going to buy this.
Yeah, I was going to add that Diablo Cody had written a screenplay several years back when Ratner was attached, and I think Ratner's a great person to make this film. Rat Pack, it's named after Dino and all the whole gang. I mean, he's kind of obsessed with that whole part of the culture. Like, he just posted a great picture of Don Rickles after Don Rickles had passed. Mm-hmm. So I think he's the perfect guy to produce the film.
I was at the Comedy Store hanging out on the front porch, as I'm wont to do from time to time, and this is about 5 years ago, and Hef walked by to a limo that was parked out there, and there was about maybe him and 10 of his, you know, Playboy models or bunnies or whatever, and they're all walking together, and Hef had like a red, like, silk, like, tuxedo on, and he had like the you know, cigar or whatever, and he just looked tired. I felt bad for the guy because he's got to entertain all these people, and he really just looked like he wanted to go to bed and watch Matlock. So I hope you get a kick out of your own movie, Hef, and I hope you get a chance to see it, and I hope that Brett Ratner does a good job producing it, because there could be a lot to say with a Playboy and Hugh Hefner biopic. All right, Ash, what's up next?
I'm just shocked that you said that you felt bad for Hugh Hefner. I don't really feel bad for Hugh Hefner.
Look, I'm a lazy guy. Like, I can barely entertain one human being, much less a bevy of people for a night out in the town. The guy just wanted to go to bed and watch Murder, She Wrote, I promise you.
I'm with you. People are like, you want to go out? I'm like, look, Family Feed's not going to watch itself. I'm very much the same way.
All right. THR is reporting that the book entitled Hostage to the Devil, written by Father Malachi Martin, has been picked up by Penguin Entertainment for a movie adaptation. The author, Father Martin, is sometimes cited as the inspiration for William Blatty's The Exorcist, and is a former Jesuit priest who wrote 17 books over his lifetime, with the original published in 1976. The book presented Exorcism as an epic battle between priest and demon, showing how the fight can be personal in nature and can span a lifetime, exacting an enormous toll on the priest who sacrifices a piece of his humanity each time he confronts a demonic force. The project will now enter active development with a release date yet to be determined. Perri, buy or sell an adaptation of Hostage to the Devil?
I'm going to buy it, but it's a light buy right now. I mean, I've never read this book, and other than the fact that he is sometimes cited as the inspiration for The Exorcist, based on what I've read in these articles and read in brief descriptions, there's nothing that I hear in this that makes it sound like, oh, it's going to be a unique exorcism movie for this way. Even the exact way it's described in the description that Ashley just read, where, oh, it's an epic battle where you could see how this kind of situation goes on for them with their entire lives. That sounds to me a lot like what Vera Farmiga goes through in The Conjuring. Mm. So until I hear something that makes this completely different, and for all I know, it does exist in the book, but based on the descriptions, I can't say that I really need another exorcism movie like this. And then another thing that just has me, you know, a little alarmed is it's a new production company, and I feel like at this point their goals might be a little too big when they should be focusing on a movie. I mean, there's all this stuff about them hopes to simultaneously adapt different elements from the book into big screen and small screen projects.
Oh, yet dear
you're,
God.
You're a
oh,
new boy. Production company. Yeah, pump the brakes a little. Get me excited about this one. And then, you know, maybe behind the scenes be planning all of that. There was also another quote, actually. Yeah, one of the quotes from one of these producers, it was, our goal is to shatter genre expectations and reset the bar for elevated supernatural fare. Mm. That is a lofty goal. And I don't know if you can achieve that. I'm sorry to tell you.
Perri, I was just going to buy this, too. I think I'm still going to buy it. You hooked me when you said that this book and this father was the inspiration for William Peter Blatty's The Exorcist. Mm-hmm. So that Captain Howdy'd me, okay? So I'm interested now. Right. But I want to see the lifelong struggle. I want this to be like a smaller drama. If I'm looking at this, we've seen so many movies, and we've been inundated with the actual battle between a priest and the demon and whatever person that demon is inhabiting. Like, you know, demon come out, or the power of Christ compels you, all that cool stuff. For this movie, I would like to see the struggle of the priest after the fact, what you deal with on a day-to-day basis, knowing that this evil exists in our world and possibly other worlds, that you just had this. It's like, I just exorcised a demon on Tuesday. Now it's Friday. And what the hell am I doing with my life? I have to live with this every day for the rest of my life, knowing that there's all these spirits out there. That smaller, intense, emotional drama is what compels me about this story. So now if I hear that there's going to be a shared universe with all these other supernatural elements, and we're going to take the supernatural, you really can't elevate it higher, in my opinion, than what The Exorcist did in that vein. So let's take it different, because the one thing I'd like to see more about The Exorcist story is the effect that it actually had on the priest. You know, I guess they didn't really make it out of that movie all too well. But other priests that would perform exorcisms.
Well, that's a really easy way to make a unique exorcist movie, right, is to just not have the third act be the exorcism.
Yeah. Call Brett Ratner. Let's get our movie produced. Yeah.
Oh, actually, there is a really good exorcism-type movie, Ava's Possessions. It's an independent movie that came out 2 years ago, and it's about, it starts with the girl being possessed, and then the movie just follows what happens to her after.
That's something that I'm kind of interested in. And that's what I think they're trying to go for with this step. Right. But then you hear this larger supernatural universe. Where do you sit on this?
Well, if you've never seen the horror movie Possession, you should. It has nothing to do with demons. It actually does, but it's not this kind of possession. But I would have to. I'm going to half buy it. Can I have to, like, tentatively crawl by it
you
or whatever?
Give
like,
your money or you do not. All right,
I'm giving them my money for the first one because they've got four left. It's like five living Americans. Well, I'm going to give them my money for one living American who was possessed and exorcised by a bunch of, you know, weird priests who are like now shattered for the rest of their lives, walking around with the realization that demons exist. You know, we could be like, I don't know if demons exist, but a priest who's done an exorcism definitively knows whether or not demons exist because he had to deal with that. So I don't know. It depends on how they do it. Like you said, you know, the thing that makes me want to maybe chuck it is we're going to expand this. We've got a web series and we're exploring. We're going beyond what normal possession things do with our brand new exploratory possession series, you know, priest or whatever it's going to be called. I don't know. So I'd like to just see Hostage to the Devil.
Yeah, I would like to see Hostage to the Devil. Jeremy, you're going to buy or sell that premise?
Yeah, throwing out the shared universe thing that we don't need for everything. I'm buying it because I enjoy exorcism stories, but I do agree there are so many of them out there. You need to do another angle. That's why Possession was the one with Aaron Eckhart, right? Was that the Aaron Eckhart movie?
No, this was the Sam Neill.
All right, what was the Aaron Eckhart one? Where they did do another take. It's not a good movie. I forgot the Aaron Eckhart one. But they do some psychological twists to it that I actually did. I give him props for trying, although the execution was in. Exorcism of Emily Rose, I actually like that
movie.
One because it's more or less a court movie, but you hear the scientific analysis of what it could be. And then you hear the priests talking about the religious aspect of what it could be. So you have information from two sides. I think that's cool. So all these ones that stand out to me, they go a different take to it. Whether or not it's the priest dealing with stuff after the fact and the second act is the exorcism, I'd be fine with that too. Different take, different approach. Let it stick with me. Let it be unique. But I do love me some exorcism movies, so I'm going
to
buy it.
But if it's called Hostage to the Devil, you would expect any studio to want to have a lot of creature effects in there.
Lame.
And a lot of jump scares. Lame. And door shutting. And then, like, what was that? Oh, it was just a cat. No, now here comes the devil.
It's
like,
always a cat.
It's always the cat, especially in possession movies. So, you know, I think I'd be excited about it. The premise gets me in there, but as usual, Perri scares me with facts.
If they get a Motley Crue to do the cover, Hostage
Shout
to the Devil.
The devil. That's
right. Aaron Eckhart was in Possession, but a very different Possession movie.
Yeah, very different Possession movie.
This one's a mystery romance.
Yeah, I have to reiterate, the Possession movie of Eckhart is not great, but the premise was interesting. It's the most interesting premise in a movie like that with the worst execution.
Yeah, the movie I'm talking about, Sam Neill discovers that his wife is cheating on him with like some kind of slug creature in a different apartment.
Jabba the Hutt, I get it.
It's a frightening, weird...
Star Wars trailer.
Look, slug creatures can be personable and charming when prodded. Well, let's move from one film that might be a shared universe to another one that we thought was going to be. Ashley, what do we got?
But it's not. With Universal Pictures rebooting their Monster Cinematic Universe and the first standalone The Mummy, the next question fans have is what monster movie can we expect to see as the next installment? In an exclusive interview with Collider's own Steve Weintraub, Mummy screenwriter Chris Morgan shed some light on the universe he's heading up, with Mummy director Alex Kurtzman revealing that the films aren't really going to interconnect the same way the MCU or DCEU movies do per se. Speaking about the slate of films, Morgan said, "We kind of designed them all to be kind of standalone sorts of franchises that have kind of similar things between them."
Say kind of again.
Kind of.
Say kind of one more time.
"And as these scripts came in, then we started putting them in a, well, this would be a good order. We reveal this here. So now it really comes down to, again, it's a studio decision on which film is coming out next." Mark, buy or sell the comments about the Monster Shared Universe by Chris Morgan.
Ashley, I'm going to kind of sell these comments because it would appear as though when they were setting this up for this giant shared universe with all these stars are going to be in it, and Russell Crowe as Dr. Jekyll appears in a trailer for The Mummy, you're connecting the parts, and maybe because there's a little bit of fan fatigue hearing of all these different shared universes that are going to be going on, now they're saying, oh, you know what? Okay, it's not going to be like that, which is fine. And I give them all the credibility in the world for not having the same level of interconnectedness that a Marvel movie would need or a DC movie would need, but I certainly think there's going to have shades of that in every movie. That's why you go see The Mummy. If you enjoy The Mummy, come back, because Russell Crowe's going to have a new adventure, whether it's with Johnny Depp or whoever else it's going to be moving forward, and I'm fine with that. I just hate when they throw it at you, and particularly when we read stories in the press about, oh, now we have this, and then we have 19 other ideas for movies such as this. I don't need to see that, but if you want to give me The Mummy, and it's a good movie, and then you want to say, hey, you might want to come back because we have a post-credit scene that involves this and this and this, this other scare, that's cool, because we all know it's going to lead up to one thing and one thing only, Schnepp. Monster Squad.
Right.
Rebooted.
Oh, yeah. I'd like to see Monster Squad done in a shared universe, but just as one movie called Monster Squad. But you know what? I like the idea of this shared universe. I like that Russell Crowe is going to play Jekyll in all these different films. I'd say, you know, grow a set and just be like, look, they're all connected. We know we screwed up with Dracula Twice Baked or whatever the hell that was called, because they were like, hey, look, I'm in the future. Get out of here. There's no sequel. Canceled, son. It's not a part of any shared universe. So if The Mummy fails and they're like, Russell Crowe's not going to be Jekyll, now it's Bob Skippy, you know, it ruins everything, because I wanted my stuff shared. Who cares? I mean, just go ahead, make The Mummy. The next one I want to see is Frankenstein. Let's just say that. Javier Bardem playing the monster Frankenstein. I think that, to me at least, I love the story of Frankenstein. It needs a new one. We already got a recent Wolfman with Benicio del Toro, which sucked. So, you know, let's leave the Wolfman away for a little bit. I'd love to see the Creature from the Black Lagoon as well. But next one I think they should concentrate on is Frankenstein.
So you're kind of selling this with me.
I kind of
Perri,
sell it.
When you hear these comments, do you take Morgan at his word that we're not going to have as much interconnected tissue as we thought?
I think I kind of have to sell this as well. It's tough, though. I am kind of caught in the middle on it, because on the one hand, you have something like the MCU setting expectations for what a cinematic universe can be. So I hear quotes like that, and I'm like, oh, that means you're unsure, and you guys didn't plan it out as well as Marvel. But at the same time, like, who's to say that their cinematic universe needs to be structured the same way? However, I still read this quote, and I read it as, like, we planned one thing, but we don't really have it planned out too much yet. And there is something to be said for waiting for The Mummy to come out and seeing audience reaction before you funnel a ton of resources into future movies. Then again, they also had a writer's room, and the point of that writer's room is to develop ideas that then do connect in one way or the other, and you plan out the whole thing, which right. It doesn't really sound like they did. But, you know, I kind of like what he said about them all being designed to be standalone, because that is another thing with franchises that tend to hurt singular movies, is that when the focus is on the big picture, that one movie isn't as good. So if that is what makes these great, good on them. But to me, I read this quote, and it just sounds like they don't have their shit together.
Kind of sells. Jeremy, you get the opportunity to be the dissenting voice at the table. Will you take advantage?
I'm not even going to say kind of. I sell it. Just because. It does sound like they're like, we had a plan, and now we're kind of changing the plan after there's all. I mean, when you
say
kind of. Yeah. Oh, did I say kind
of? You did say kind of.
Damn it.
But it's hard not to.
Yeah. It is hard not to, because it all is in the fringe of kind of. But I do definitely sell it. But when you see Dr. Jekyll in it, and he is compared to being the Nick Fury of this monster universe, how are you going to then be like, well, it's not really Nick Fury? I mean, when things happen in this movie, and then that person that was in that monster movie goes on his other adventure, what happened in that first movie will affect what he does in the next movie, or should affect what he does in the next movie. If they're not connected, don't connect any of the characters. If the characters are in it, it is innately going to be connected. So just commit to that. It looks kind of reactionary, and as much as you want to say, all right, maybe there's fan fatigue, the fact is, financially, there's not yet. I mean, there may be people saying there is online, but in the end, the connected movies do make more. I do want what's best for the vision, but I feel like if the vision was already laid out to be connected, commit to that vision. So I think it should be connected, and I do sell this whatever bullshit damage control it is. Like, well, it's not really. It's not really. It's connected.
That's why you go to Jeremy Jahns, folks, for a hard sell, not this kind of stuff that we did. This could all be a smokescreen, too, because people are speculating that Tom Cruise might be playing a character actually named Van Helsing, in which he might have further adventures. So maybe that's just say, hey, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Either way, let's get here, Mommy. Let's see what you're all about. Well, we're going to find out what you guys are all about, because in a few minutes, we're going to open the floodgates to Twitter. You guys can tweet us right now at Collider Video. And at the end of this here show, we're going to take some of your live tweets, thanks to our gatekeeper Wendy over there. In the meantime, we have a lot of shows, a lot of excitement this week. First of all, coming up later today on Collider Video, we have a live episode of Heroes hosted by that young man, Jon Schnepp, right over there. That's going to be coming up at 1 p.m. PST. Also dropping today is our preview vid of the Schmodown free-for-all, which airs Friday. So there's no team match today. We gave all the competitors a break because the free-for-all is going to be an endurance trial. It's going to be a lot of fun, a crap ton of competitors that you know, a lot of surprises, and all the frivolity begins this Friday on Collider Video. And also, Jeremy Jahns has a new episode of Awesome Tacular that's going to drop this Friday. You guys can check out the Verizon Go 90 app. It's free to download, so just go ahead and download it right now. You get to see all of Jeremy's greatness. There's a lot of us that pop into the vids from time to time, and maybe even a celebrity will do a press conference. Who knows what's going to happen. The whole crew is going to be at Star Wars Celebration this weekend. Like we said, me, Perri, Jeremy, some other luminaries here, including Christian Harloff, John Campia, Dennis Zhang, and a host of others, Ken Knapsack. We're all going to be at Star Wars Celebration. We leave tomorrow. We have a lot of events coming up. And like I said at the top of the show, we are going to have an official fan meet and greet. That is going to be on Thursday night from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. It's going to be right across the street from the convention center at an awesome bar called Fat Fish Blue. It's a really nice bar. They have a lot of good food, and they have a nice outdoor patio. Plus, it's conveniently located right next door to the Improv Comedy Club, where I'm going to be Thursday through Saturday. So you might hear that, and you say, oh, well, it's Thursday. I need to be in line for the Last Jedi panel. I'm not sure I can make it. Don't worry. We have a lot of events that are going to be going on all weekend, but our official meetup is going to be 9 to 11 on Thursday night. That's going to be just following our Jedi Council panel. That is going to be from 6:30 to 7:30, and that is in fan room W308. That's a good room to know, because W308 is not only where Jedi Council is going to be Thursday night, but also the following day on Friday from 3 to 4, we're going to have the Star Wars Schmodown event, which is going to be a fatal five-way, including Jenny Nicholson from Screen Junkies, Ken Knapsack, John Campia, that guy right there, Jeremy Jahns, and Sam Witwer in a battle of Star Wars wits. It's going to be three awesome rounds. You guys are going to get to watch it live if you're at Star Wars Celebration. Jeremy, I got to ask you, you're going up against Darth Maul himself.
Yeah.
How do you feel about your chances against everybody, including Mr. Witwer?
You see, the trick is to not underestimate your opponent, Mark. This is going to be the fatal five-way. It doesn't even begin to scratch the surface of what this event is going to be. This is going to be a bloodbath of Star Wars knowledge among the most knowledgeable people of Star Wars that ever traversed a galaxy this or far, far away. I'm liking it. It's going to be a lot of fun, but I got to know my shit. I can say that. I got to know my shit.
Literally can't wait, and I expect to be seeing Jeremy and Ken watching Star Wars The Clone Wars movie on the plane as we get to Orlando tomorrow. Make sure you guys check out all the panels and our official meet and greet. Once again, Thursday night, Fat Fish Blue, 9 to 11 p.m. With all that out of the way, we're going to move quickly to mailbag. You guys can email us anytime and ask us a question. Collidervideo@gmail.com. Sometimes we answer it here on Movie Talk. Sometimes we do it on our weekend show, Mailbag. We have one today. Ashley, what came in the mailbox?
Denny writes, hey, Collider crew, love what you're doing, and especially your rundown of the trailer yesterday, which got me thinking, with the trailer for Thor Ragnarok getting such positive responses from you and fans, do you think Marvel makes better trailers than DC? Keep up the good work.
I think Marvel makes better trailers than DC. Well, hang on as I get my latest check from Marvel. No. I don't think they do. I think they both make great trailers. I went nuts when I saw the Justice League trailer. I went nuts yesterday when I saw the Thor Ragnarok trailer. I think they both make awesome trailers. If I had a criticism about any of the trailers, it's that the DC ones, when you talk about Batman v Superman, gave us a little too much. But it seems like they've course corrected from that with the Wonder Woman trailers we've gotten. They've been fantastic. All the Justice League stuff we've gotten. So I am very happy with both Marvel and the DCU trailers. I think they're great. The actual movies they're advertising, that's where it gets debatable. But Schnepp, I think with the trailers themselves, they're all doing it right now.
Yeah, for sure. I think, one of the most exciting trailers I remember from 2015 was Suicide Squad. You know, that was really exciting. You're like, wow, this is going to be so much fun. I mean, Justice League as well. You know, Thor Ragnarok, what a fantastic trailer. I think that's my favorite trailer of the year. It's just so fun. You know, there's action. It's pulse pounding. It's got Led Zeppelin. That's right. You know, you can't beat it. So I can't say which one is better. They both make really good trailers.
Are you saying Immigrant Song isn't Herman's Hermits? I thought that's...
No.
All right. I'll have to do some fact-checking. Jeremy, DC, Marvel. Does one have better trailers than the other?
I love the divide. What can I say? I love that good old fan DC versus Marvel divide. I think both are great, man. I love cake and ice cream. I love steak and potatoes. Why do I have to choose between the two? My appetite craves all things. I'm with you guys. I had a great time with the DC trailers. I've had a great time with the Marvel trailers. I had a great time with the It trailer. It's not even DC or Marvel. I just like myself a good trailer so far. All parties after that Batman versus Superman that did show too much, everyone's doing a great job right now. It's the marketing's fantastic. It's the film execution that really matters.
Jeremy likes steak and potatoes. Perry, you like hot coffee and cold pizza. What about Marvel and DC trailers?
An awful rumor that's been started. I think I have to pick DC because It is my favorite trailer of the year, and It is from Warner Brothers, so that makes me favor DC, right?
That's crazy.
I echo everything you guys said. I mean, trailers, everyone I think has been crushing it. We talk about superhero fatigue, and then I come to the end of the year and I look back at some of my favorite trailers of the year, and often that is what's up there. I mean, last year, in particular, talking about DC, because those are the ones that are coming to my mind right now, some of the most exciting stuff that came out of San Diego Comic-Con last year was when that Wonder Woman and Justice League mm-hmm. trailer dropped. Mm-hmm. I was freaking out, and all the promo material for Suicide Squad. I mean, go over to Fox with Deadpool. Holy crap, that was a great promotional campaign. And then looking at this year, that Guardians 2 trailer is definitely going to be one of my favorites of the year, and I love the Thor one. So basically, the conclusion of this is love for all trailers, kind of.
I just want to know which trailer got the most cash for their respective music artists. Was it Led Zeppelin getting some iTunes bumps for Immigrant Song? Was it Johnny Cash getting for his version of Hurt? I don't know what it was, but I would like to see those numbers. Okay, we are going to move on to your live Twitter questions. Wendy, we got time for a few tasty ones. What's up first?
All right, well, this one apparently is a tough choice, and it comes from Jack Cole, who writes, Joe Shoemaker, Yuva Bull, and Michael Bay. One directs a DCEU film, one MCU, and one Star Wars. Who does which?
Okay, I'm not giving you Bull the Star Wars movie. Yeah, that's what I'll say off the bat. I can give him a DC movie. I'll give Joel Schumacher a choice. I might be able to give Schumacher. Who is the other filmmaker?
Michael Bay.
Michael Bay, I can't get him near a Star Wars movie either. Although, when you see Rogue One and you see 13 Hours, it's like, oh, this guy could do something like that. So I think I might do the unthinkable here, guys. I'm giving Michael Bay a Star Wars movie. Have at it, buddy. It's a galaxy far, far away. Just get the hell away from Transformers. And Joel Schumacher, maybe you can make up for Batman Forever with something in the Marvel Universe. Guys, call me crazy.
You're not that crazy. What was it? All right, so Uwe Boll would get Marvel, because I just want that one Marvel movie where people are like, screech the brakes, it never happened. You know, like, I just need that to happen in that universe.
We need a cooler.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We need like, look, they're mortal, all right? Not everyone's paid to review it. All right, so that's got to be the way it is. Where are the other ones? Michael Bay and Joel Schumacher?
Yeah.
I like to call him Shoemaker.
I agree. Michael Bay could probably... Oh, God. Hold on.
I think if he's working with the Brain Trust, he could make a good...
I feel like Joel Schumacher should get another crack at DC again.
Okay.
Because fans would just backlash, and all he could do was impress people.
Sure.
You know, like people's expectations further down there. And I'll give Michael Bay Star Wars because, again, I just... this scenario will give nothing but venom to the internet. The internet will get so much poison, it'll become a self-aware entity. It'll be the blob. It'll be the thing from the Black Lagoon that Schnepp wants to see.
Yeah.
That's the pick, knowing that that was just a no-win scenario.
If you're joining us late, this was a Twitter question. This is not Jeremy and I's idea to give Michael Bay a Star Wars movie. We're forced into a corner. We gave him the flick. What say you, Perry?
I have to play this game. I really don't
you
like this
You
question.
Have to play this game.
Because I don't think any of these directors are suited for any of these properties.
Yes. No, they're not.
That's why it's a tough choice.
That's why she picked
I'll give Bull DC, Schumacher Marvel, and
Michael Bay gets another
and Michael
Star
Bay
Wars
gets Star Wars.
Shep!
Wow. I was going to give Bay Star Wars, but I have to go against the grain just because he got Star Wars from all you guys. I would give Bay a Marvel property. I would give him something like off the beaten path. I would say Michael Bay directing Howard the Duck could be incredible.
That Michael Bay humor.
Because it's like it would be, Pain and Gain I actually like.
Yeah,
so
okay.
I could see, you know, as long as he's not writing Howard the Duck. I'm not saying he's writing it. He's directing Howard the Duck. Howard the Duck and Man-Thing together again in a buddy picture directed by Michael Bay. So Michael Bay gets Marvel. Schumacher gets Star Wars.
Okay.
And I would make Schumacher in charge of like a cantina movie with Salacious Crumb because I'm going to get my saga son of Salacious Crumb. It's like before he died at the hands of Jabba. He just hung out on Tatooine, and Schumacher has to direct this movie.
Fun fact, Salacious Crumb is actually a lawyer, so it could be like in the realm of A Time to Kill.
Yes. I think that would be great, and that was directed by Schumacher. And Schumacher actually wrote Car Wash, so he's a pretty competent
guy. Car Wash, yeah.
And that leaves, I guess, Uwe Boll with DC. Mm-hmm. Sorry, DC. boy, what would he make?
Nothing. He would make nothing good.
No, it'll give him something. Let's see.
We're going to need an answer.
I think one of his better movies was Rampage, which was like, you know, adapted, you know, from, you know, it's a crazy, violent film of gun nuts. So I would say Vigilante.
Okay. Mr. Bull? Get your script ready. Wendy, please bail us out of this weird Black Mirror episode we've entered into.
What happens if, like, in a couple of weeks, like, it breaks, Michael Bay directs Star Wars?
Then we'll blame ourselves, and we'll all have to drink Kool-Aid.
I think we need another Twitter question like
You're
now.
Welcome, Hollywood.
It is totally our fault if Michael Bay gets a Star Wars movie. We're sorry about it, the internet.
Not my fault.
All right, this one comes from Waleed, who writes, thoughts on Elizabeth Banks claiming that Hela's look was taken from her take on Vita Repulsa and Power Rangers?
I haven't seen Elizabeth Banks' comments.
Serious?
I gotta think it's a joke.
I saw that on Twitter. I think it's playful.
Banks, like having fun on Twitter.
Yeah.
She's just having fun.
Yeah, so if she's having fun, I think it's hilarious because, like, we joked about it yesterday how Hela resembles Maleficent, and certainly there's some Rita Repulsa shade in there as well. Now, if Hela is in the middle of Thor Ragnarok and decides to venture to Earth to go to Krispy Kreme, then we have something to talk about.
Sure.
Until then, I think it's just all in good fun. And you guys see that differently.
Yeah, she kind of does look the same if Hela had a really bad meth binge behind a really dirty dumpster, then she'd become Rita Repulsa. I mean, Hela looks like any Eva Green role ever in the past 10 years is what she looked like to me.
I also got to say, Hela looks pretty accurate to Jack Kirby's drawings from the 60s, so that's what she looks like.
All right, what's up next?
Okay, this one comes from Robert, who writes, hey, Collider crew, with Star Wars Celebration coming up, is there any crew left to entertain us?
Is there any crew left here in Burbank to entertain
us?
Of course there is. We are going to have movie talk, and it's going to be from our normal studio here in Cincinnati, Ohio, from Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. So, Wendy, I believe our schedule's running as normal. Dennis, is that correct? Yes. Thumbs up? Yep. Getting the yes from Dennis, although Dennis himself is not going to be at Star Wars Celebration. Looking forward to it, buddy. Okay, well, let's do two more.
Dennis.
Okay, buy me a lot of stuff, guys, by the way. all right, Mathman, who writes, what are the chances that Groot is taken during Guardians post-credit and it makes an appearance in tournament in Thor Ragnarok?
Ooh, that's interesting. I feel like Thor Ragnarok was taking place during Civil War. That's why they weren't there. Mm-hmm. So when does Guardians 2 take place is the question. That would be an interesting take. Depending on how fast he grows, I think Guardians 2 would have to take place, 10 years before in order for that to happen. But we'll see what happens.
That's a pretty exciting thing to see a matriculating Groot in Guardians of the Galaxy 2 or even Thor Ragnarok. How about you, Perri?
I'll watch Groot in just about anything. I just don't. I don't know how it lines up, so it doesn't seem like it would make that much sense.
Well, Schnepp, we're getting Guardians 2, right, in a scant couple weeks.
Yeah.
God, we're going to see Guardians 2.
Yeah,
and then we get Thor Ragnarok this fall. So do you see Groot growing accordingly?
I don't think so. I mean, I don't think Groot's going to show up on the planet Sakaar or whatever it's called, so...
All right. Well, maybe Yui Bowl would have something to say about that. Wendy, do we have one more Twitter question?
Yeah, I can do one more. Charlie wants to know, what are our predictions for Fast 8's box office for the weekend?
All right. Well, I'm not going $200 million for this, baby. Nope. I'm not even going with the record-breaking weekend that Fast 7 had. I think there was a lot of confluence of events that all came together, some tragic, some positive, with good trailer word of mouth. So I don't think you're going to get like that $140 million weekend. I don't think you're going to see that again. I would say this settles around, I'm going to say $90 million opening weekend for Fate of the Furious.
I think it's high. I'm going to go 72.
Oh, wow. I'm going to go 100.
Okay. Yeah. Perri, going high?
I was between 70 and 80, so I'll go 75.
So you're saying 72. That's like half of what Fast 7 made opening week.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's a lot more stuff coming out. There's a lot more stuff out right now, and there's less, Paul Walker.
It's in good shape right now, though, because the heavy hitters like Beauty and the Beast and Boss Baby will be on their way out, and look at what it's going up against.
I can't believe we just said heavy hitter is Boss Baby.
Born in China is going to make $400 million.
I can't believe we live in a world where it's like, hey, The Last Jedi, make sure you're not opening against the Boss Baby Part 2, because that's going to be a monster. Yeah. All right, well, we'll have to see. Make sure you guys comment in the YouTube comments with your prediction on Fate of the Furious' opening weekend box office take. With all that out of the way, thank you guys so much for joining us here on this episode of Movie Talk. We're looking forward to seeing a lot of you guys at Star Wars Celebration. Huge thanks to everybody here. Cody, Riley, Adam, Dennis in the back, and my panel of panelists. Thomas up here with me, Jeremy Jahns, my fellow button-down brother. Where can the kids find you?
You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on YouTube, Twitter, rest of the internet. You can find my show Awesome Tacular on Go 90. It's a lot of fun. I do stuff with these two crazies right over here. Schnepp and I talk comic books. Ellis and I throw pies in each other's faces if we're not just doing games. It's a lot of fun. Important to know that I know jack shit about box office numbers, so please don't tweet me when I'm wrong.
P. Nemi, can the kids tweet you if you're wrong?
I'm not going to be wrong, so tweet me all you want at P. Nemiroff on Instagram there as well. And the full Guillermo del Toro interview dropped this morning, so if you like what you saw on Collider Nightmares, you should go check it out. It's a lot of fun.
That's right. They had a snippet on Collider Nightmares. Now the full interview is up on the channel on Collider Video. Check it out. Mr. Jon Schnepp, you're going to be on Heroes a little bit later on today, the live edition. Where else can the kids check you out?
Oh, yeah. We're going to get extra deep and sweaty about that Thor Ragnarok trailer. You guys can find me on Instagram and Twitter just at Jon Schnepp. Get my Slayer comic. Issue number 2 is out all around the world. Buy it.
Over yonder, when she's not knocking down Oscars off our shelf, Ashley Mova, where can everybody check you out? I see everything.
I thought no one noticed. You guys can find me on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Ashley Mova. Happy Tuesday, guys.
Wendy Lee, thank you for not knocking any of our collectibles off the shelf today. Where
no,
can everybody find you?
No, they already flew off the shelves by themselves. You can find me on YouTube at the Movie Couple channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Wendy Lee Zaney.
My name is merely Mark Ellis. You guys can find me on Twitter at Mark Ellis Live. Go to Mark Ellis Live. For all upcoming comedy tour dates, including this weekend at the Improv Star Wars Celebration. If you go to the meet and greet, I'm going to be right next door. 8 p.m. is that start time. We'll get out by 9:30. You're done with the show. Come on over, say hi to the rest of your Collider favorites. Thank you guys for tuning in to Movie Talk, and we'll see you guys tomorrow right here on Collider Video.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.